running into the throne room. God, help me, help me. You see, oh Father. Yeshua said to his disciples, he said this, listen, let us go over to the other side. Remember that? He said, got in a boat. He said, let us go over to the what? Other side. Now, when the Messiah said that, he means we're going over to the other side. Because whatever the Son of God said must come to pass. And so they got in this boat, and suddenly this gale of wind came. And the master was sleeping. And the disciples began to wake him up. Master, we're perishing. You don't care that we're perishing. You run into the throne room. Help! And the master gets up, rebukes the wind and the waves, and he said, where is your faith? He was training us, brethren, because he knew that he was going to go away, as it were. He would be, but he's still in your boat. And what he wants you and I to do is this. Deal with the wind and the waves, and then wake him up and tell him what happened. Don't wake him up to rebuke the winds and the waves. Where is your faith? If you are seated in heavenly places, the master said, let us go over, we will not go under. I say it again. The master said, let's go over, we will not go under. But you have to use your faith. Father, help us. And so as we continue on, we've seen what the master is giving us. He wants us to have dominion over the enemy. He wants us to render the enemy powerless. He wants us to fight, brethren. He says that stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, that's the priestly garment, not a Roman soldier, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In addition to all, taking the shield of Emunah. Take the shield of Emunah, which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. What's a flaming arrow? I submit to you, the psalmist says, a flaming arrow is a bitter, harsh word of condemnation. And if you don't have the shield of Emunah, that condemnation will get into your mind and you will be inflamed. How dare they say that about me? They've spoken. But if your shield of faith is there, it will be quenched. Because you will know that arrow cannot come to you, it cannot touch you, unless Elohim has allowed it to come to you, and he's allowing it to come to you so that he can test you, to reveal to you what is in your heart. There's something that we tell our husbands and wives. You say, listen, there are two things. When you squash a skunk, what comes up? The smell of a skunk. The crushing of the skunk the question is going to just cause the smell of the skunk to come out. It was already there. Oh, yeah. The skunk smell was already there. The pressure just caused it to come out. When you crush a rose, what comes out? Pleasant odor. And so you and I, we go into these situations, and we are so dainty. We said, butter can't melt in my mouth. And so I'm so dainty. And then suddenly you hear some words flying. Left, right, and center. Where did that come from? It was always there. The skunk smell was already there. The situation just brought it out. And now we have to go before Elohim and say, Father, forgive me. Remove this from me. Help me to smell like the rose of Sharon. Oh, Father. So our response is our responsibility. Stop going around and say, you see, you make me do this. My wife make me do this. You make me get vexed. Really? No, nobody didn't make you get vexed. It was already there. Abba, help us. And so we're going through life victorious, brethren. In Psalm 110, I want to share this with you quickly. While we were home praying about coming to Canada, Abba, by his spirit, would have given me this psalm for Canada. And I came, I had the opportunity to discharge that burden in another congregation. And wherever I go through Canada, I've been declaring this psalm because I'm taking the sword of the spirit. That's what we just read. He said, take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Take the sword of the Spirit. And as you are here, that is what God is saying to you and I. He said, I have a sword for you. Take it. There is a word that is coming out from you, a rhema word. He said, take it. Grab hold of that sword. Wage warfare with it. Say, it is written. Say, thus says the Lord. Take the sword of the Spirit and do warfare. And I said, you see what's happening? He said, how are you going? I said, how are you going, my child? How are you going? Well, under the circumstances, what you're doing under the circumstances, you should be above the circumstances. Amen. Where are we seated, brethren? In heavenly places. So in Psalm 110, we read this. Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, Yah says to my Lord, sit at my right hand. That's where we are. seated in Messiah in heavenly places, sit at my right hand, until with a view towards what? I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. That's what's happening. And then the Lord will stretch forth your strong scepter from where, brethren? Zion. I find a number of people wanted to get into spiritual warfare, but they have no concern about Israel. Listen, he's stretching forth his strong scepter from Zion, because that's where he defeated the enemy. If your prayer is not about praying for the peace of Jerusalem, if it's not about bringing the restoration of Israel, then we are praying amiss. You stretch forth your strong scepter from Zion. All right? I said, rule in the midst of your enemies. I pray, God, that somebody would take that sword. That's the sword he's giving you. This is the sword. Take it. What's the sword? Rule in the midst of your enemies. You go through life, rule in the midst of your enemies. Why? Because you're seated in heavenly places. Verse 3, your people will volunteer freely in the day of your power. In holy array from the womb of the dawn, your youth are to you as the dew. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. He's telling us about what's happening in the heavenlies according to the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings in the day of his wrath. He will judge among the nations. He will fill them with corpse. And verse, the last part. He will shatter the chief men over a broad country. That's the sword that God told me, take it, my son. I said, what? Let me read it again. He will shatter the chief men over a broad country. I'm leaving to come to Canada. Isn't your country a broad country? Isn't it? Yes, it's a broad country. He said, my son, take this sword. Through you, I will shatter the chief men over a broad country. And begin to realize, wait, their chief men over Canada that seem to have not been resisted and contested. And people are going through life in Canada like if that's how things have to be. That's how the judicial system has to be. That's how the laws have to be. That's how the congregation has to be. No, beloved. He wants us to do what? Shatter the chief men, the principalities, powers, and rulers of darkness over Canada so that Canada could be free to serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There are areas of Canada that has not yet been penetrated with the gospel. How do we do that? You and I come here and we take our position in the heavenlies and shatter the chief men. Amen. Who established Canada? Consider, Selah. Chief men, and he wants us to shatter. But if you are squabbling about what this Torah word means, when should we have Passover? When should we do this? And we're squabbling and we're disagreeing, and the enemy is just having a field day. Father, make us to be bridal soldiers, that we would fight the good fight of Elohim. And so he's calling us, brethren, to shatter. Wherever I go over your chief, over your broad country, I'm declaring this word. Because it's the sword of the Spirit that I take. I said, over Niagara Waterfalls, I shatter the chief men, the principalities, powers, and rulers of darkness that is over the religious system that has opulence, but yet there is a drought of the word. Sheep without shepherds, being tossed to and fro, going from place to place, can't find rest. Because the beasts are ravishing the flock. And no one is rising up and say, enough. But this congregation, I pray stability. I pray security. I pray the grace of Elohim. And you're going from strength to strength. There's so many things, brethren, that could trip us up. In Timothy, we have what is called the doctrines of demons. 1 Timothy 4, verse 1 to 6. You see that the doctrine, the Spirit says explicitly in the last days that people will depart from the faith because giving heed to what? Doctrines of demons. In 1 Timothy 4. And so he's telling us, listen, even right here where we are, there are doctrines of demons. And he wants to awaken us to what is happening. Doctrines of demons said, forbid marriage. And it says, there's certain foods that you should abstain from. Let me tell you a doctrine of demon, brethren. When the Torah says forbid, the doctrine of demon will tell you what? Permit. When the Torah says permit, the doctrine of demon will tell you what? Forbid. Because it's contrary. And do you find it interesting that he's saying forbid marriage? Marriage is still between male and female, beloved. Still, but as I told people, he didn't make Adam and Steve, he made Adam and Eve. Male and female. Still. And so Abba is calling us to this understanding, to fight and to stand against the works of the enemy. And you and I have been given that responsibility, brethren. You see, brethren, he says to us, everything that God created is good, but not everything is good for food. Everything is good, but not everything is what? Good for food. He tells us what to eat and what not to eat. And he tells us, be careful, ensure that you remove all the blood. Because the life is in the blood. That's Torah. We learn how to walk in obedience. We study the Torah to know how to walk in obedience. We study the Torah to know the goal of the Torah is that we become like Messiah. And so we're going to and fro through the book. And we're seeing in Revelation. There's some things in Revelation, brethren. I pray, God, that the leaders, that you would focus and look at those letters given to Revelation. Because in the book of Revelation, you have letters given to the congregations. And each congregation seems to have something that they hold. Some hold the teaching of Balaam. Some hold the teaching of Jezebel. Some hold the teaching of this. It's like we hold all these things. And the master said, in every congregation from that time, down until when he comes back, we'll be holding something. And I said to you, brethren, just as Abba said to Moses, what is that in your hand? He said, it's a rod. It's a rod. He said, throw it on the ground. And when he threw it on the ground, what happened? It became a snake. I submit to you, there are teachings that are in the Messianic community that need to be thrown on the ground. And suddenly we will see demons coming out of it. Things that we hold daily and feel, yes, that must be so. Demons. And they're uncontestably because they come into shoe looking very nice and lovely and enjoying your love feast. But behind it, it's a work of the devil. And God says to us, you know me, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The God, the so-called God of Allah, of Muslims, not the same as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's a lie.
Right. Hallelujah.
Everything that, every plant that the enemy has planted will be uprooted.
Right.
In the name of Yeshua. And so we continue to see, go with me quickly, the 1 Timothy 1. There's a passage there I would like to share with us quickly. 1 Timothy, our Father. 1 Timothy says this. He says, don't instruct men not to teach strange doctrines, verse 3. And verse 4, nor to pay attention to myths and endless genealogies which give rise to mere speculation rather than the furthering of the administration of God, which is by faith. God is saying to us, that's what I just said, you and I could be discussing which genealogy, which tribe we come from, all sorts of things. Torah just engenders all sorts of quarrels and fruitless discussion. And Abba wants us to administrate the victory of Calvary over the enemy. But you and I don't know the fight because we are being distracted. And look what happens. But the goal of our instruction is love. From a pure heart, a good conscience, and sincere faith. When you finish doing your midrash, if this is not being made manifest, then we have gotten into verse 6. For some men, strained from these things, have turned aside to fruitless discussion. Why? Because wanting to be teachers of the Torah, even though they do not understand either what they are saying or the matters about which they make what? Confident assertions. Everybody becomes a Torah expert. And my view must be heard. God is saying, I want to give you the view of heaven, that you have lived in peace with each other. And so Abba is calling us, brethren, to understand these things. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, we have something else as I share with this congregation. 1 Timothy chapter 6 from verse 3, we have, if anyone advocates a different doctrine, and does not agree with some words, those of our Lord Yeshua HaMashiach, and with the doctrine conforming to godliness, he is conceited, understands nothing, but he has a morbid interest in what? Controversial questions. My God. God is saying, your interest is morbid. It is not based on love and facilitating community. It is based on division. Who is behind that? Hasatan. May his name be blotted out. And God says, listen, I've come to challenge that in the name of Yeshua. I love you. I bless you. I know my fight is not against flesh and blood. It's not against you, but if you get in the way, you will get hit. It's not against you. I'm against the enemy that is inspiring you to do things that are wrong. And Abba is saying, you got to rise up and come against that. We have been given authority by the enemy, and by Abba's grace, we have cast out demons. We have done that, been there, done that, bought the t-shirt. We cast out demons. People come into our congregation, and they have all sorts of teaching, all sorts of strange doctrine. We have deliverance service, we have mikvah service, and we deal with those principalities. Why? Because Yeshua went about teaching Torah, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing the sick, and expelling demons. And the Messianic community needs to come to that place where we understand there are demons to be expelled.
Right.
In our midst. It needs to be challenged. Why? Because they will destroy the flock. So out of which arise envy, abusive language, evil suspicion, and constant friction between men of what? Depraved mind. Deprived of the truth. Who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. Father, please help us. And there are those who ears are tickled. They want to be teachers. Going about to and fro. Everything on the internet you're getting. And you're coming and you're dividing the flock. It's the spirit of the enemy. Father, watch over your sheep. Watch over your sheep. As I go to this last scripture as I close. 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 21. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from these things, he will be a vessel for honor. Father, burden this congregation for your honor. Not for their own honor, but for your honor. Burden us to be vessels of honor, and burden us to be vessels that would desire your honor to be manifested. Sanctified, useful to the master, prepared for every good work. Now flee from youthful lusts. And this is what you should pursue. Righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. But refuse, not entertain, refuse foolish and ignorant speculation. Well, where did Cain get his wife? Oh, Father. Knowing that they produce what? Quarrels. We are brethren. You have your opinion, I have mine. You have faith, I have faith. You have faith, have it unto yourself. Don't try to foster it and impose it upon others. We are brethren, let there be no strife. Agree to disagree without being disagreeable. The Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome. Once you begin to see that, you know it's not the spirit of Elohim. It's another spirit. Messiah said, you know not what spirit you are of. But be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wronged, with gentleness, because you love the sheep, with gentleness, correcting those who are what? In opposition. If perhaps God may grant them teshuvah, leading to the knowledge of the truth. So while you're in conversation, you should be praying, Father, grant me teshuvah, and grant my brother or sister teshuvah. If I am wrong, show me. If he or she is wrong, show them. But we have love one to another. I could disagree with you concerning this or that, but I could sit down to you at Oneg and enjoy. If I cannot sit down with you after discussion, then our discussion was what, brethren? Fruitless. And we go about wanting to establish our own righteousness when God is looking to bring shalom within the congregation. He said, that they may come to their senses, which means that we matter. Which means we're not in our right minds. We are not in our right senses. So we need to come to our senses. Because we are intoxicated with our own arguments. We're not sober. And escape from the snare of the devil. Having been held captive by him. You would think that him there is the devil. No. Being held captive by the servant of Elohim. Because God told Peter, you will catch men. And the hymn there refers to the bond servant. I am passionate to catch men. I want to seize you, catch you, so that I could bring you to the Father's will, to do his will. Not the will of the enemy, but listen again, captive by the servant of Elohim, so that you could do the will of Elohim. There are too many things in the Messianic community that we need to really address. The insistence of the sacred name, multiple wives, Lunar Shabbat, discrediting the Jewish people. Listen, if you say, I am Jewish, okay, I am Jewish too, but I don't have to be Jewish and discredit those who are Jews. No, they are not Jews. And you quote the scripture, but those who say that they are Jews, listen, in the Messianic community, he's not talking about those in the people of Israel. He's talking about those within the congregation, this congregation, and all other congregations who would say they are Jews, but are not. Now that word comes to you. Suddenly the table is turned. You are thinking it meant them, but God's saying they're talking about you. Are you saying that you're a Jew and you're not? I make no boast in my ethnicity. I don't deny it, but I put no confidence in the flesh. I put confidence in Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeshua, he is Elohim. Secondarily, I am of Jewish descent. But if that is going to cause a stumbling, you will be the Jew, I will be the dog. What do you mean by that, Rabbi? Listen, Messiah said to the woman, it is not suitable to take the children's bread and cast it to the dogs. And we look at that meaning, did Messiah call the woman a dog? No, beloved. If you could receive it, he was saying this. I became a man to die for you. I became a bondservant to die for you. I became a dog to die for you. Where is Boston? He became like a dog to die for me. I would gladly be his dog. No, I am a lamb. I am of Judah. I would gladly be his dog. I will follow him wherever he goes. Because he took on the nature of a dog to die for me. That's what he was saying. He was not condemning Gentiles. He was saying you need to understand your inbred hate and your animosity and contempt and arrogance. But I still love you. You're going back to your vomit, but I still love you. And I became a dog to die for you. There's a passage that said he took on a dog's head in Judah to die for me. That's why I can minister to the Jewish people. I can minister to the Gentile people. Because I'm both. I'm of Jewish descent, and I'm also of Gentile descent. And I thank God that it's both. Because I could relate to both sides. To the Jew, I become as a Jew. And to the other side, I become. And I love all. Because God is wanting to bring one new humanity. And so, brethren, you and I need to stop fighting. Stop fighting against each other. Woman, you are loose. You are loose to be all that God has called you to be. Man, you are loose to be all that God has called you to be. I pray, God, that you would continue in the grace of God, be strengthened in faith, walk in fervent love, bring forth the fruits of righteousness. I pray that you would pray for your elders and your elders would pray for you. I pray that there would be no lashon hara among this congregation. I pray that if you have a teaching that is otherwise, that you would keep it to yourself and have faith before God and discuss it with the elders so that they could wait and discuss it rather than go and cause discord among the flock. It may be this is not the place for you. It may be. I've learned graciously the doors swing both ways. Now understand that. Shall you also go away? I understand that as a teacher, some would disagree with me. I still love you. I still bless you. May you find your purpose in God. I don't hate you. If I find that I am wrong, then I will have to come across to what you're thinking. If you are wrong, then hopefully you will come across also. But I love you. And I pray, God, that this congregation would indeed be strengthened with strength in the inner man. I pray that you will not be tossed to and fro, brethren. We weep and pray for Talmidei. Knowing a little bit of your history, we weep and pray for you. Because we know that in our departure, that ravishing wolves would come, sparing not the flock. From among you would rise people having their own agendas and would seek to defy the flock. And I pray, God, I will never hear when I call Sandra, how is this congregation doing? I said, Rav, we are no more. Because we've heard about congregations that would have started and they're no more. Because wolves came in and nobody had the authority and audacity to cast the wolves out or cast the people out. Let me say that again. You cast the demons out of the people or you cast the people out? So what? Read it, it's in the book. It's in the book, brethren. We love you, it's not against flesh and blood. But if you're coming in with a divisive attitude, if you're coming in to not spare the flock, then your agenda is satanic, it's not divine. And somebody has to say, no brother, not here. No sister, not here. This is the flock of Elohim. This is the flock of Elohim. And brethren, judgment begins right here. So things happening in your life, and you wonder, why is this happening? Is it possible that you raise your fist on your hand against somebody, and this is happening? Measure for measure, judgment begins in the house. Father, help us to discern what you're doing. So, beloved brethren, It has been an honor and privilege to share this burden with you. There's so many more things that I could share with you, but my wife told me, no, I hope I didn't transgress that statement. Keep in line. And I always have to battle with that. Father, help me. The spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet, so okay, keep in line. But there's so many more things I would like to share with you, brethren, because my passion is that you be equipped to fight the good fight of faith, and that you would not be tossed to and fro by the enemy, but that you would grow from strength to strength. Really be disciples of the Master. Really be like the Messiah. Disciple, you've taken that name, so you need to be discipled in the Master. Walk so closely behind him that you're covered with the dust of the Rabbi Yeshua. Love Yeshua. Love Yeshua, brethren, and love those who love him and have not seen what you have come to understand yet. That's what I said. Did I say that? Yes. Love those who go to church on Sunday. You have to love them. You think they're serving some false God? Really? I was serving that same false God, and I think he's still there. It's not false, brethren. You don't come out of the church with a chip on your shoulder and feel all those sun worshippers. God forbid. He loves them too. So you can agree to disagree without being disagreeable. We were having dinner with a pastor, and he asked me about Sunday worship, and I told him, listen, you could worship God at any time, but remember the Shabbat. I said, if you want to have service 1:38 a.m. in the morning, Baruch Hashem, you have the liberty to do that, but remember the Shabbat. That's it. I said, if you can't remember, if you cannot observe, you can remember. What do you mean by that? God says, remember and observe. When my Jewish people were in the camps with Hitler, we could not have observed, but Hitler couldn't stop us from doing what? Remembering. So we're going out and we're busting rocks and we're doing hard work and hard labor. But Shema Yisrael, Adonai, we have nothing to cover our head. I put my palm upon our head. Of Shema Yisrael, I love you, Father. I can remember even if I cannot observe. Why am I saying some of you have been challenged with having to work? Don't be condemned. Say, okay, I have no faith. I have to give up. No. Pray to Elohim. Even if you cannot observe, this is not license to disobey. Listen to what I'm saying carefully. If you cannot observe, you can do what? Remember. Until such a time as you could remember and observe. There is liberty. There's grace in the Ruach HaKodesh. I pray, God, that there will be demonstration, signs and wonders in this congregation. I pray, God, that you would grow from strength to strength. Father, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I lift up Talmidei before you, and I pray in the name of Yeshua as I hold this, the precious flock of Elohim before you, that you would bless them and keep them, that you would make your face to shine upon them and make them to be prosperous, that you would give them your countenance, your portion of understanding the Torah, and give them your shalom. I pray, Father, that you would equip them to fight in the heavenlies. I pray that you would equip them to love on the earth. I pray, oh God, that they would discern the spirit of the enemy, and they would rise up, submitting to you, resisting the enemy and causing him to flee. I pray, oh God, that this congregation would be an example to other messianic congregations. I pray, Father in heaven, that there would be love and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. I pray, Father in heaven, that each one would know his role and function. I pray, Father in heaven, that if any has teachings that are otherwise, you would reveal them, and that we would agree to disagree without being disagreeable, and that we would foster community among the congregation, not each one doing what's right in their own eyes. I pray that you would bless this congregation. Make them even more prosperous than SRMF. Bless them, Father. Send them forth throughout Canada. Bring people to them from the east, the west, the north, and the south. Give them stability, wisdom, and encouragement. Strengthen the elders with strength in their man. Strengthen their wives to serve alongside with them. Strengthen the husband to free their wives to serve you, O God, and to minister the word of God, non-seasoned control. Father, bless the children. Bless this place. And Father, we declare, according to your will, you would even give to them their own building in the name of Yeshua. Yes. You would establish them in Canada, because they would rise up to fight against the forces in the heavenlies and contest against doctrines of demons here in the earthlies. Yes. Father, we thank you that this congregation will go from strength to strength. Yes. From faith to faith, oh Father. You will increase them mightily. Oh, you would bless them and increase their territories, Father. Oh, that your spirit would be with them and that you would go with them. Oh, Father in heaven, that you would equip them to be one new humanity, that the Jewish people would be welcome here, that people from the nations would be welcome here, and there would be unity, and there would be no arrogance and ignorance and contempt, but Father, unity of the spirit in the bond of peace. Yeah. Thank you for this beautiful congregation. Thank you for the people, Father. Thank you for causing us to see them in the flesh and to pray for them. And lift them up before.